This is the circuit board of a Haier mini split air conditioner, and it's showing an E7 error. This is a 1-ton PCB. Let's check it out to see what the issue might be. So first, we'll test it on the series board, because the series board quickly reveals any issues. For this, I've directly connected the electric supply. Line and neutral are properly connected. Now, the system is ready for testing. The reactor wasn't installed initially, so I've added it as well. Let's supply power and check how it behaves. I'll connect the positive and negative properly. You can see that I've placed the communication wire aside for now, and I'm not using any functions with it yet. Next, I'll connect the mainboard's wiring to the PCB. So let's turn it on now. When we switched on the bulb, it lit up properly, which indicates there's a short circuit present. Mostly, when we attach the board to the series lamp, the bulb lights up briefly and then turns off. This suggests that something in the SMPS, capacitor, or another component might be shorted. I currently have 3 PCBs here, and I'll be sharing some information about them. This first one here is larger in size, commonly used in 2-ton units, though it's also sometimes found in certain 1.5-ton models. Similarly, you've already seen the 1-ton PCB that I'm discussing the issues about. Besides that, I also have a 1.5-ton PCB. The size of the 1-ton and 1.5-ton PCBs is nearly the same. Now, the information I want to share with you is about a key difference between them, especially when comparing the 1.5-ton and the larger 2-ton PCB. There are specific differences in the larger PCB used in 1.5-ton and 2-ton units, and today I'd like to explain these differences in detail. I've explained this in a couple of previous videos as well, so if you've already seen those, that's great. As you can see, this PCB is used in both 1.5-ton and 2-ton units. In this PCB, we can directly check its power circuit, whereas with other PCBs, I'm testing it by connecting it with the IPM board. Let me explain the reason behind this approach. The power PCB has a separate bridge rectifier and capacitor for its SMPS, so that the power supply works within this PCB. The microcontroller and other components operate through this SMPS. In contrast, the two large capacitors here work alongside the bridge rectifier, providing power to the IPM, which then drives the compressor. Essentially, the bridge rectifier and capacitors are dedicated to the compressor, while this PCB has its own separate system. This is a great information that you should have. So can the 1-ton circuit be used in the 1.5-ton unit and vice versa? I've often observed that they typically cannot be interchanged. The reason is that while these PCBs may look similar externally, their internal programming is different. They will not communicate with the indoor unit PCB. You'll likely encounter errors due to model differences, or they simply won't work together. Even if they do function, it's often accompanied by faults. Generally, they can be exchanged among similar models, but when it comes to the indoor unit having different specifications, they won't work together. However, there is one common feature among them that I want to point out. These PCBs do not have a separate bridge rectifier. Instead, the bridge rectifier comes from here. This is where it's connected. As I mentioned earlier about this PCB, the same design is used for both 2-ton and 1.5-ton units. While the external design may look similar, the internal design varies slightly. Nevertheless, they are generally constructed in a similar way. Here, the power comes from the bridge rectifier, and it's supplied to the large capacitors, which in turn provide power for the SMPS to operate. This is a significant difference. We cannot operate this PCB without the other PCB, because no power will be supplied through the bigger PCB without the IPM PCB. On the other hand, this PCB can be tested directly, meaning we can check it without the IPM PCB. We can measure voltages and confirm whether it is functioning properly or if it has faults. In the next step, we'll supply power again and we'll check the backside of the PCB. So here we have two LEDs. Look at LED number 2 here, and over here is LED number 1. Each LED functions differently in various situations. The second LED will turn on if power is reaching the capacitors, indicating that the system is receiving electricity. If the first LED doesn't light up, it means that the SMPS isn't working, which prevents the microcontroller and other components from receiving power. Let's turn it on to check if both LEDs are working. I'm following the same procedure, using the series board, where I've already done all the settings. Now, I'll supply power and turn it on. As you can see, the light has turned on, indicating that there's a short circuit. However, LED 2 is also on, which means electricity is reaching the capacitors correctly, so they are fine. This suggests that the issue is likely within the SMPS itself, Next, we'll examine how the SMPS operates, which requires us to understand its ICs a bit. Inside, we have a PWM IC with the number 1200P100. You can look up its datasheet for reference. Additionally, there's a power MOSFET with the number 4N60ZG. You can check both of these components and use their datasheets to guide your work. Now we'll check the SMPS, examining the voltages at various points and identifying any faulty components. There are typically three or four potential issues. If the chopper heats up, it could be defective. The power MOSFET, which you can see here, may also fail, or the PWM controller could be faulty. The PWM controller sends pulses to the power MOSFET. As there's no internal MOSFET, it's external. Therefore, we can't call it a switching IC, as it only sends pulses to the power MOSFET. When the power MOSFET turns on, it activates the chopper. Additionally, the TL431 IC here could also be faulty. If it doesn't provide the correct feedback, the SMPS won't function properly. There's also a 45 ohm resistor that can sometimes prevent the circuit from working if it fails. This is resistor number 18. The power for the switching IC comes from this point, so we need to understand its function carefully because we can't proceed without grasping this part. Let me explain how the chopper or transformer works. On the backside of the PCB, you can see two capacitors, and from here, the power is taken to convert DC to DC. Here, this is the positive side, and this is the negative side. If you follow the positive path, it eventually ends at pin number 1, where it's marked as T1, indicating the chopper or transformer. On pin number 5, ground should be present. Only if there's a ground connection here, then these two points will get connected. So once the coil inside the chopper is activated, it will start producing the DC to DC supply, allowing the PCB to function. Now that I've applied direct power to it, I will check where the problem lies and see what might be faulty. Let's look at pin number 1. This is the adjust pin. After that, pin number 5 should provide some voltage. I'll take ground from here and measure the voltage. It shows 2.4 volts, which indicates that it is working correctly. This indicates that there might be a fault in the MOSFET. If the MOSFET is faulty, it won't function properly. Now, as I showed you earlier, this is the drain pin on the backside. Let's check the voltages here. We'll take the positive supply from here and check if we're getting 320 volts at the drain pin. Let's do a quick test to see if the voltages are coming through. We'll reconnect it, taking the positive supply from this pin. We can also take it from the resistance connected here. Now, looking at the MOSFET's drain, it seems we're not getting any voltage. If we connect to pin number 4, we see that almost 300 volts are present, but they aren't progressing further. This suggests that the switching IC is likely functioning correctly because we previously observed voltages of 2.4 volts when we tested it. This indicates that the chances of the MOSFET being faulty are quite high. Let's replace the MOSFET and see if that resolves the issue. Now I've replaced the MOSFET. We didn't have the same MOSFET available, and this type is quite hard to find, so I removed the faulty one, number 4N60ZG. I've put in a different MOSFET that is a bit larger, but it will serve as a suitable replacement. Let me show you how it works. I'll flip this over to check the lights to see if they're functioning. Now I'll connect the electricity directly, and the switching should occur. It has started working perfectly. As you can see, the first light has turned on, and now the second light is on as well. We can also hear the switching sound coming from it. When both lights are on, it means the PCB is fully operational and functional. This is how you can easily replace components to fix the issue, but identifying where the fault is located is crucial. Click on the left or right thumbnail to watch our next videos and subscribe. Thank you.